Okay, so last time we had done the Fermi gas and the specific heat of the Fermi gas. So today we are going to explore some other properties of the Fermi gas. So my aim today is to do two things. One is to look at electrostatic screening. Okay, and through this, explain the concept of the Mott transition. And the other thing that I aim to do today is thermionic emission, which can also be done at the level of the free Fermi gas. Okay, so let's begin first with the first topic. And the Mott transition is very simply stated as a metal to insulator transition. Okay, so it's basically a metal to insulator transition. Now, metal to insulator transition is a very interesting topic, because if you can change the properties of a system from being a highly conducting system to a highly insulating system, then there are many potential applications. Okay? So, for example, most transistors, they do amplification of the current, and there are things like, well, let me not mention that. Let me ask you guys first. What are the mechanisms you guys think can be used for converting a metal to an insulator or an insulator to a metal? Okay, so I want you to give me certain mechanisms for converting a metal to an insulator or vice versa. And if you know of any example where such a mechanism is applicable, even then you can tell me. Go on. Any suggestions, any answers?
Sir, we can have disorder induced transitions.
Very good. So, disorder induced transition. So, do you
Yes.
have an example for this?
I have read Anderson localization.
Okay. So, Anderson localization. And
And we can also have some one is Mott transition.
yeah, so the Mott transition is what
And
you do. So, one second. So, when you say Mott transition, what do you think it is induced by?
it is induced by, actually, I have read it from some Hubbard model, and there I had two terms, which one of them was the site energy term, and another was a term which was responsible for spin-spin interaction.
I see. Okay.
And from comparison between these two terms, we can find conditions when the system will be like a transistor, sorry, like an insulator, and
Good.
in some cases it will behave as metal.
Yeah, so the thing is, what you're talking about is a model-based scenario for a metal to insulator transition, right? And
Yes.
we will come to that, right? We will come to what are the models for this Mott transition or the metal insulator transition. But do you know of any real systems or any real perturbations that can be used to convert metal to insulator or vice versa in experiments? So you see the question, right? Because you mentioned certain parameters of a model. Do those parameters of the model relate to any experimental parameters? And can you tune those to convert the system from a highly insulating state to a highly metallic state?
I had two parameters, but those were parameters from the theory. Those
Exactly. So do
were
they relate to any?
experimental parameters.
Yeah. So do they relate to any experimental parameters?
I can't say that.
No problem. No problem. It's fine. Don't worry. So we will come to that, okay? They have a strong relation to experimental parameters as well, and we'll come to that. Anybody else? Any other perturbations that we could use?
We can also have band insulators.
Band insulators, but the thing is, if you are given a band insulator, for example, I give you silicon or I give you diamond, for example, right? These are all band insulators. Can I convert them to metals using some perturbation? Using some field, for example. anything at all?
I don't know if some external field can help in this or not.
So external field, what kind of field do you think? Magnetic field, electric field?
So can we change the band gap by applying pressure?
Okay, so pressure induced, yes, you're right. So the pressure induced transitions are also possible, but they don't end up changing the band gap because the band gaps are usually of the order of electron volts and it's very hard to change the band gap. But there is another mechanism which is related to the Hubbard model context that Shomita was talking about. And through that, one can induce pressure induced, one can find the pressure induced transitions. We will come to that. Okay. In fact, I will show you examples where pressure can induce a metal insulator transition. Okay. And then the other thing that was mentioned was field induced. So field induced could be either magnetic field or there can be electric field also. Right. So there can be electric field induced transitions, and I'll come to this as well, why this is important. Anything else?
There can doping be used.
Doping, very nice. So doping has two effects. Okay. What doping does is that it can change, for example, the electron density, which is what it does in the case of semiconductors. Okay. But it can also induce disorder. Okay, so it has a dual effect, right? But then there is a third thing. Okay, so doping can actually induce chemical pressure. So doping induced electron density changes is known to everyone. Basically, if you introduce either an electron rich or electron poor compound into, let's say, silicon or germanium, you can induce or you can create a p-doped or an n-doped semiconductor. Right, and through that you can convert the semiconductor to a reasonable metal. Disorder, doping induced, because dope a system, then you don't know where these dopants are going in, right? So they would normally create a lot of disorder, and through that you could have a disorder induced Anderson localization, right? So if you're starting with a metallic state, then you could have a doping induced transition to an insulating state. But there is also another thing that doping does. Doping can also induce a chemical pressure, because the dopant can have either a larger size than the host atom or a smaller size than the host atom. Okay. So if the dopant has a larger size, what would happen is it will actually push the neighboring atoms, right? So pushing the neighboring atoms amounts to applying a strain on the entire system, which is kind of, you know, pulling the system apart. Okay, so it's actually a negative pressure. So a larger dopant induces a negative chemical pressure, and a smaller dopant induces a positive chemical pressure. Okay, so dopant can have many different effects. Anything else? What about light? Photo-induced. Was there any other thing? Any other mechanism that anybody can think of?
Sir, photo-induced is different from field-induced?
Yeah, so these fields we are talking about are basically DC fields. Whereas photo-induced would be an electromagnetic field.
Okay.
Yeah, so that's the difference. See, this electric field induced transition is actually a very interesting one. And this came up in one of the recent thesis colloquiums by Bharat, who was Professor Kulkarni's student. So can somebody tell me why this was important, whoever attended that talk? Okay, can somebody tell me why this electric field induced metal insulator transition was important? So let me also tell you, he talked about neuromorphic circuits. And for him, the transition from a high insulating state to a low insulating state was extremely important. And if you can drive that by electric field, then that would be extremely useful. But what was the mechanism that he found for converting this system from a high insulating, from a highly insulating state to a metallic state?
There was some formation of metallic threads.
Very nice. Okay. So the idea was that there are these grains, and in between these grains, there is a host material. And what happened was, by the application of an electric field, he could see the formation of these filaments. And by the formation of these filaments, there could be conducting paths which could be created. And the interesting thing was that this actually induces memory into the system, because this is a permanent, this is not a completely permanent effect. It can actually be reversed as well, but it's a kind of a memory effect. And through this, one can create neuromorphic circuits, basically circuits which learn. Okay. And these are not software based like machine learning or AI kind of thing. These are hardware based neuromorphic circuits or hardware based neurons. Okay. Which learn through this application of clever applications of electric field. Okay. And then I will be giving you some examples of this pressure induced transitions. I will show you some examples. Okay. And then doping induced is something that most people know, how silicon can be converted from an intrinsic semiconductor to a good metal, to a p-doped or an n-doped metal. And then the photo-induced one, I don't have ready examples now, but if you find in the, if you search the literature, you will definitely find them. Okay, so you can convert using light also. In fact, it's very important in the case of polymers. So polymers in dark do not conduct, but there are several polymers which, if light is incident on them, they start conducting. Okay, so that's a very important thing. So let's talk about the Mott transition. And the Mott transition was originally envisaged by Mott in the 1960s. And he gave certain mechanisms of converting a metal to an insulator or otherwise, or vice versa, through this phenomenon called electrostatic screening. Okay, so this is what we will look at today. And the Mott transition is a specific kind of a transition, which, as you see here, I have not mentioned really. Okay, and what you will see is that the Mott transition actually falls under this category, the pressure induced transitions or the doping induced transitions. Okay, so we will see how this pressure induced pressure and doping can actually induce these kind of Mott transitions, and how the original concept given by Mott has still not been probably completely realized. Okay, there are several mechanisms that have been brought forth, but none of them correspond to the original ideas of Mott. Okay, so let's see what happens. Okay, so any questions so far? Okay, so the point is that let's consider a Fermi gas. So this is all, remember, in the context of a non-interacting Fermi gas, right? What I want to do is, inside a Fermi gas, I want to introduce a small perturbation potential. So how do I do that? Let's say I introduce a small charge Q inside this electron gas. Okay, so introduce a small perturbation potential. And this small perturbation potential is given by, let's say, delta U of R. Okay, so the point is that because it's a Fermi gas, there are electrons which are moving around. They will try to screen this extra potential. Okay, and it's this screening which will lead to a damping of the bare Coulomb potential. So what do I mean by that? Let's say I had a box, and this box did not have any electrons. Okay, so this is an empty box. And inside this empty box, I introduce a charge Q. And I want to ask, at some distance, okay, distance R from here, what is the potential? And you will tell me that the potential is given by Q by 4 pi epsilon naught into 1 by R. Okay, so this is the bare Coulomb potential. But now let's take another box in which this Fermi gas has been placed. And I do exactly the same thing, right? And then I ask, at a distance, what is this delta U of R? Okay, so because of the presence of other electrons in the system which are mobile, they are going to screen this charge Q, and that kind of a screening will lead to a change of the electrostatic potential. It will not be 1 over R anymore. Okay, and what we will see is that this will actually turn out to be e to the power minus lambda R by R. Okay, so this e to the power minus lambda R term is what is responsible for the damping of the electrostatic potential. And what that means is that electrons which are far from this impurity, far from this extra charge Q, will not be able to see this charge Q. Okay, they will move about as if there was no charge, there was no extra charge, right? Only those electrons which come very close to this, within a distance of 1 over lambda, will be able to feel this charge Q, or will be able to feel this potential, will be able to feel the bare potential. Okay, so let's see how that works. Okay, and this is a very simplistic argument done without any quantum many body arguments. So you will find many levels of approximation that enter this argument, but finally the answer that you get is actually correct, and the arguments leading to this answer are also reasonable. Okay, one can understand them in a sort of a approximate way. Okay, so what is the idea? The idea is that, let's say the density of states in the absence of any extra perturbation potential is given by square root of E, and this is the density of states. This we have seen for a 3D Fermi gas, density of states, it's square root of E, and there is a certain Fermi energy which defines the highest occupied level, and all the states below the Fermi level are completely occupied. So this is in the absence of any extra potential. Now what would happen when I add an extra potential to this? What would happen is that this density of states, the energy of these electrons will change. And what would happen is, where the original Fermi energy was, okay, there will be a change. And this extra piece here is the extra change in the density of electrons. Okay, and this change in the energy is basically E times delta U of R. Okay, so what we are going to do is, we are going to find two relations between the change in the electron density and the extra perturbation potential. Okay, and we are going to find this extra this perturbation potential self-consistently. Okay, so this is what we are going to do. And the first thing to realize is that the change in the number density delta N of R is given by the density of states at the Fermi level. Okay, you can see that that is where the change is, maximum change is happening, times the delta E, okay, which is the extra energy that has been supplied to the system. Okay, and this turns out to be D of EF times E times delta U of R. Now already we have made certain assumptions here, which you can see is not really a very rigorous assumption. What we have done is, we have taken the local change in the electron density to be proportional to the local change in the perturbation potential, okay, to the local perturbation potential. So in some sense, what we have done is, we have actually mixed energy space and real space. Okay, so this is the basic approximation, but this is known as the Thomas Fermi approximation. Okay, and this is the equation, this is the approximation that leads to a closure of the set of equations. So the next equation that relates delta N and delta U is a rigorous equation, and that is the Poisson's equation. So what does the Poisson's equation say? That if I want to find out this del square of delta U of R, then that is given by minus rho by epsilon naught, minus delta rho by epsilon naught. Okay, so this is a rigorous equation, but then what is the change in the charge density? Okay, so that is given by just E times delta N of R. by epsilon naught. Okay, so now you see we have two equations. One relates delta n to the delta u, and the other one that relates delta u to n, to the delta n, right? So using these two equations, we will be able to convert the second equation to a pure differential equation. And from that differential equation, we can figure out what is the delta u of r, right? So given this, let me erase the top part.
Sir, can you explain from the density of states once again? I could not hear because of the network issue.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. So what we are saying is that the density of states in the absence of any extra perturbation potential is given by square root of E. That is what I have drawn here. This is D of E versus E in the absence of any extra potential. And then when we add this extra perturbation potential, it's going to change the energy of the electrons. And the energy of the electrons now starts from the E times delta U. So the entire density of states gets pushed up. And the change in the electron density will be basically given by delta N of R, which is equal to the density of states at the Fermi level times this energy window, okay, delta E. And this energy window is basically given by E times delta U of R, because that is the extra potential that was introduced into the system, okay? And this is one equation, and this equation is not a rigorous equation. It's actually a mixture of real space and energy space arguments. Okay, so but it is known as the Thomas Fermi approximation, and this was first used to figure out what is the electrostatic screening that happens in a Fermi gas. Okay, and there are other rigorous arguments which replace this, but to introduce them we need quantum many-body theory. And that we don't, I mean, for that we need a completely new formalism. So let's not go into that, but just just accept this approximation and then move forward. Okay. So the next equation that relates the number density change to the extra potential is given by the Poisson's equation. And that is just a rigorous equation. Del squared V is minus rho by epsilon naught, where this change in the charge density is given by E times minus E times delta N of R. So is this clear now?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this is, let's say, equation one, and this is equation two. So by combining these two equations, we would arrive at.
Sir, initially when delta U was zero, there was vanishing density of states at zero energy.
Yes.
But in the presence of delta U, there is non-vanishing density of states.
So that's correct.
We understand that.
So see, that's what I was saying, that here we are talking about a local change in the density of states. Okay. So first of all, the assumption here is that the change in the potential is very small. Okay. It's a small enough perturbation that you can do a Taylor's expansion of the density of states around the Fermi level. That's the first thing. Second thing is here, if you notice here, there is a delta N of R and there is a E times delta U of R, right? So we are talking about local changes in the density of states due to local changes in the potential. Okay, so in that sense, the there are no electrons at zero energy because you have pushed this electron, you have pushed the energy of the electrons by some energy E times delta U of R. So imagine putting in some kind of a charge into the system, okay, and that charge has induced a potential. Okay, and that potential changes the energy of the electrons by E times V. Okay, but because that is local, then it has to be E times delta U. Okay, and do you understand that? It's just change in the energy of the electrons. Instead of having a pure kinetic energy, which is what was used for calculating the density of states, okay, we now have a potential energy also, but that potential energy is due to the external potential that was introduced into the system. Is that clear?
Okay, so this density of the state we have drawn is around delta U. It's not for the whole crystal.
Oh no, exactly. You're absolutely right. This is a local picture and the density of states has only changed locally. That's correct.
Okay.
Okay. So far from the impurity, the density of states is exactly the same as before. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Absolutely right. So this is the essence of the Thomas Fermi approximation. Yeah. Okay, so given these two equations, 1 and 2, the delta n of r can be eliminated and we arrive at one single differential equation, which is del square times delta u of r is e square times the density of states at the Fermi level divided by epsilon naught times the delta u of r. Okay, so this equation can be solved in spherical polar coordinates. Okay, so basically we will use del squared is 1 by r squared, del by del r of r squared del by del r, right? So if we use this, then it turns out that the solution for this turns out to be delta u of r is alpha e to the power minus lambda r by r, where lambda squared is given by e squared d of ef by epsilon naught. Okay, and this alpha is a constant that is fixed by the differential equation, by the initial conditions of the differential equation. And to fix that, we can use the limit when r tends to 0. Okay, so basically we are saying that suppose you introduce a charge and you go very close to the charge, right? Very close to the charge means that you should be able to feel the bare Coulomb potential. So when r tends to 0, e to the power minus lambda r becomes 1, and you would be left with. So if 1 over r, what should be the coefficient? Then that coefficient should basically be q by 4 pi epsilon naught, where q is the extra charge that was introduced, right? So which means that this perturbing potential becomes equal to q by 4 pi epsilon naught times e to the power minus lambda r by r. And you can see here that this exponential term is controlled by the density of states at the Fermi level. Right, so that's the most important thing to realize, that whatever the density of states at the Fermi level is, that is what is controlling this lambda. Right, so if the density of states is extremely large, then this lambda is going to be large, which means that the damping is going to be extremely strong. So let's just think about this equation for a while, and that will lead us to many conclusions. Are the arguments clear now? Any doubts?
So the R is defined from the center of the Fermi gas, right? So what is the?
No, not center of the Fermi gas. No. See, there is no center of the Fermi gas. Initially,
if you take a box,
yeah,
and then if you place a charge at the origin,
that's correct. But see, what happened was that when we considered the Fermi gas, then we applied periodic boundary conditions. Okay.
Okay.
Suppose you take a 1D system and you apply periodic boundary conditions, there is no origin.
Yes.
Right? Same thing for a torus and same thing for a 3D periodic boundary conditions box. Okay. So there is no real space origin, so to say. Okay. And what we're doing here is we are placing the charge somewhere and calling it R equal to zero because we have broken the translational invariance.
Okay.
So, and we want to solve this problem in spherical polar coordinates with respect to that perturbing potential. That's the idea.
Okay. So yeah. Somewhere you mentioned about this energy and this is mixing between the R and energy.
That's right.
So the density of states, this is an assumption, right? So we are taking the delta NR as a density of states and...
Absolutely. That's an assumption. So that is the essence of the Thomas Fermi approximation, that the change in the electron density is given by the density of states at the Fermi level times the change in the energy of the, or the delta E that was introduced by the perturbing potential. Okay. And this change in the energy of the perturbing potential turns out to be dependent on the spatial coordinate because you are introducing a local perturbation.
Okay.
And if you want to do this more rigorously, then you have to bring in the Green's function. Okay. Which will be a function of r and r dash.
Yes.
And by looking at the changes in the Green's function due to this external potential, right, then you can figure out what is the change in the electron density spatially. Okay.
Yes.
And that would be the more rigorous argument, but that obviously involves Green's functions theory. Okay. So let's just analyze this delta u of r. And this is given by some alpha times e to the power minus lambda r by r. where the lambda squared is E squared times D of EF by epsilon naught. Okay. And using this lambda, let me define a length scale called Thomas Fermi screening length. Thomas Fermi screening length. And that would be given by 1 over lambda. So it's basically E squared D of EF by epsilon naught to the power minus half. Okay. So what does this RTF physically mean, right? So if I write delta U of R in terms of RTF, then it means R divided by RTF divided by R. And if you want to write this also in the same way, then you can write this. Okay. So in a normal system, the delta U of R, let's say in the if there was no Fermi gas, okay, in vacuum. In vacuum, delta U of R would be just given by 1 over R, right? So if I plot the delta U in vacuum versus in a Fermi gas, then I would find a 1 over R. This is 1 over R, and this is for vacuum. And for this Fermi gas, I would find a strongly damped function. Okay, so this is e to the power minus R by RTF divided by R. Okay, so what does this mean? This means that suppose there were charges placed here, and remember the extra charge was placed at the origin, right? So if there was a charge placed here in vacuum, then it would still feel the potential due to this charge. However, inside a Fermi gas, because of the screening by other electrons, the electrons which are far from the impurity, even in, you know, 2 to 4 lengths away, 2 to 4 times the Thomas Fermi screening length away from the impurity, would hardly feel the charge. Okay, so that's the main conclusion of this, that this RTF is a screening length, and this screening is actually electrostatic screening by the other mobile electrons, by the other electrons, by the other fermions in the system. Okay, so this is electrostatic screening. And now this leads us to a kind of a mechanism for the Mott transition. Okay, to see that, we have to analyze this expression for the RTF more carefully. So let's analyze the expression for the Thomas Fermi screening length. Yes.
Sir, here we are not considering the charge.
Not considering what? Sorry, I lost you, Shovik.
Sir, here we are not considering the charge of the fermion. That means fermion's gas. But here we are talking about some screening. Then if we don't consider the charge of the fermion, then how can we say that this is the screening? But that I want to say that the screening should be, we should consider the charges of the fermions also.
Understand. Very nice. Okay, so let's start from the beginning then. What was the model we considered? So, Shovik, what was the model we started with?
Sir, I don't understand.
We started with a certain model, right? What was the model we started with? It was a Fermi gas. So why don't you unmute yourself, because this is going to be interactive. Okay, I'm going to ask you certain things. So the model that we started with, your question is an excellent question. Okay, and let's discuss this. So the model that we started with was a Fermi gas model, and a Fermi gas model means that we are considering electrons which are not interacting with each other at all. How is that possible? As you said, electrons have charge, right? But we have started with a model where the electrons are completely non-interacting. And if they have a charge, then they should be interacting. So how is it possible to even consider a Fermi gas model?
Sir, you told in very first of this class that when there is a large density, then at a certain point the total interaction and the vector sum will be cancelled out. So we can treat free electron approximation when the density is quite large.
Correct, but that doesn't give you a mechanism, right? That is only a statement. I just said that with high electron density, you can assume that the electrons will be weakly interacting with each other, but that does not give you an argument. Okay, see, your question is actually a self-consistent question. So what I mean to say is, if I normally consider a crystal which has positive ion cores sitting at certain lattice positions, and I consider valence electrons moving about in that crystal, then the entire system as a whole is electrically neutral. Okay, but not only is it electrically neutral, given a high electron density, it turns out that these electrons, they don't interact with each other strongly as a through a 1 by r potential. In fact, the interaction between them is also of the same form that we derived just now, the Thomas Fermi screening approximation. Okay, but given all of that, I said let's consider a non-interacting electron gas. Okay, so because I considered from the beginning gas, interaction between electrons has already, we had already assumed electrostatic screening to be operative inside the Fermi gas. Okay, so in that sense, our starting point itself does not have interaction between electrons, even though they have a charge, they do repel each other. Okay, all of that has already been subsumed. Do you see the point now?
Yes, sir. But the Thomas Fermi screening lens is strongly depends on the density of Fermi level. So the Fermi level is the most important thing, and Fermi level is related to the density of electrons as well. So the number of electrons per unit volume is the ultimate parameter.
Correct. Yeah, we are just coming to that. Yeah. Okay. So let's just analyze this Thomas Fermi screening length. And then through that analysis, we will come to the concept of the Mott transition, which is how Mott originally envisaged this. Okay, so let me just clear this. Okay, so the Thomas Fermi screening length, this TF, RTF, is basically 1 by lambda, is given by E squared times D of EF by epsilon naught whole to the power minus half. And what we had done is, we had when we considered this Fermi gas, then we had found out the density of states as a function of the electron density, right? So the D of EF was found to be equal to 1 over 2 pi squared 2m by h cross squared. Oh, by the way, all of this discussion is given in IBAC and Luth. Okay, so you can read up more in there. So the D of EF is given by this times 3 pi squared n to the power 1 by 3. Okay, so which is actually also given by 3 by 2 n by EF. So the density of states is related to n to the power 1 by 3, right? Which means that 1 over R TF squared, which is equal to lambda squared, is given by 4 by pi 3 pi squared to the power 1 by 3 n to the power 1 by 3 divided by a0. And if you calculate all of these numbers here, then this turns out to be equal to about 0.5 times n by a0 cube to the power 1 by 3. Okay, and this means that RTF is approximately 0.5 times n by a0 cube. Any question where this a0 is basically the Bohr radius and is given by 0.529 angstroms? Okay, so given this expression, RTF is this, we can take, for example, copper. Okay, in solid state copper, if we find out what is the electron density, then it is roughly 8.5 into 10 to the power 22 per centimeter cube. And using this, the RTF turns out to be about 0.55 angstrom. Okay. So this is really surprising. Or is it surprising? It's not really surprising because the free electron model works really well for copper. Now, this RTF being so small, it's actually sub-angstrom, implies that the interaction between an extra charge, which could be an electron itself, okay, and the electrons present in the system extends only to the range of half an angstrom. If two electrons are at least, you know, one lattice parameter away, which is of the order of 3 angstroms, already they would not feel any interaction between them. Okay, so remember the delta U of R was e to the power minus R by RTF divided by R. So the 1 by R potential is actually damped extremely strongly by e to the power minus R by RTF. And if RTF is half an angstrom and the distance between two electrons is, let's say, one lattice parameter, which is, for example, 3 angstroms, right? Then you have an e to the power minus 6, which is damping the 1 over R potential. So the interaction between this extra charge that has been introduced into the system and the electrons has been damped very, very strongly, okay? But now, what is the mechanism for the metal insulator transition? So the idea is that if I take this N here, okay, change the electron density. And by changing the electron density, what am I doing? I'm changing the Thomas Fermi screening length, right? So if I decrease that electron density, then the RTF increases. Now, what does RTF increasing mean? So if I decrease the electron density, then RTF will increase, and that would mean that the interaction potential has a bigger range, has a higher range. Okay. So let's say that I had an interaction potential which was, for example, attractive. Okay, so I introduced a small well into this Fermi gas. Now, normally, only if an electron is extremely close to that interaction potential, only then it will form a bound state. But now what we are doing is, if we are changing the electron density and making it smaller, then the range of this interaction potential is going to be larger. And if the range of the interaction potential becomes larger, then you can see that there are other electrons which, even though they are not very close to this interaction potential, they can also form a bound state. But what does a bound state mean? A bound state means that an electron will not be able to conduct anymore. Okay. So by changing the electron density, we have changed the Thomas Fermi screening length. And by tuning the Thomas Fermi screening length, which means we have tuned the electrostatic screening, we can change a metal into an insulator or vice versa. Okay. So this was the original Mott transition concept. That is, by tuning the electrostatic screening of an external potential, of an extra potential that was introduced into the Fermi gas, right? One can tune a system from a metal to an insulator or in the reverse way, right?
But can you just,
yeah.
Sir, can you just repeat the bound state concept?
Yeah, yeah. So what I'm saying is that, let's say when we introduced a bare potential, which was some kind of a potential well, okay? Now, this was in vacuum. When we introduced this into the Fermi gas, then we saw that the range of this potential becomes extremely, extremely small, okay? So it becomes very, very narrow, okay? And only if the electrons are extremely close to this, then only then it will be able to trap the electrons. Okay, but what we are doing by changing so this is with delta U equal to zero, and this is delta U finite. But then if we change the density and make it smaller, okay, then the range of this potential becomes larger. Okay, and if the range of this potential becomes larger, then the electrons which are not very close to it can also be trapped by this interaction potential, by this external potential, and because they can be trapped, it will form a bound state. There is a possibility of forming a bound state. See, remember, the amplitude of the potential is also getting damped. Okay, so the Thomas Fermi screening does not really capture that. It does tell you that when R tends to zero, it's still going to blow up, but that doesn't happen. Okay, there is actually a cutoff as well, right? But the bound state formation argument is still okay because you are changing the range of the potential. Okay, and this can be done by tuning the electron density. So what we are saying is that when the electron density is very high, the electrostatic screening operates and any external potential is screened very effectively. But if you tune the electron density, make it smaller, then the electrostatic screening becomes less effective. Okay, the electrons start seeing the electrostatic potential at larger distances, and you can have the possibility of the formation of a bound state, right? And what this bound state means is that the electrons will not be able to conduct anymore. Okay, they will not be delocalized anymore, they will get localized, and when they get localized, they will not be able to conduct, right? So this is a electrostatic screening induced metal to insulator transition. Okay, so that's basically the idea of this MOD transition. But in more recent times, this MOD transition has been morphed in many different ways. So let me come to the discussion that we had in the beginning of the class. Okay, that is, what are the different mechanisms or the variants of this MOD transition? But before that, there is one estimation that we would like to do. That is, we would like to estimate when can a bound state form. Estimate the formation of a bound state. So, and this will basically lead us to estimate of an electron density. Okay, estimate of an electron density threshold, which will lead us to a metal to insulator transition. Electron density threshold, which will lead to the MI transition. So how do we do this? Basically, we want to say that the RTF squared should be much greater than A naught squared. So why is that? Because remember, the lattice parameters are usually of the order of angstroms, right? So if the Thomas Fermi screening length is very large, only then the electrons will start feeling the potentials, and only then the bound state can form. Okay, so with this criterion, if you substitute the RTF that we had obtained earlier, what you would see is that n to the power minus 1 by 3 is much greater than 4a0. Okay, so this is what we get. Okay, and this kind of a threshold has actually been verified in many different systems. Okay, so let me now show you some experimental data. Okay, okay, my mouse has got stuck. That's why. Yeah, so let me show you some experimental data. Can you all see the screen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. Okay. So, so this is a picture that I have taken from the MOTS original paper. It's a reviews of modern physics review where he had reviewed his own transition. Okay, and this was 1968. So what you see here in the y-axis is basically conductivity, and this is inverse temperature. The x-axis is inverse temperature. So the left side would be high temperature, and the right side would be low temperature. And what you see here are several different materials: VO2, V2O3, VO, and so on. And let's focus on this V2O3. right? So this vanadium sesqui oxide or this vanadium dioxide also. So this V2O3, if you see here, there are two lines corresponding to V2O3, and the conductivity seems to be increasing, okay, very slightly as we decrease the temperature, right? And then suddenly it drops. And if you see closely, it's almost six orders of magnitude drop, right? The conductivity drops, and if the conductivity drops, it means it's going to a highly insulating state. So it's going from a decently metallic state to a decently insulating state. See, remember, metals and insulators have resistivities differences of the order of even, you know, 16 to 18 orders of magnitude. So six orders of magnitude doesn't seem much, right? But technologically, this can be extremely useful. And what you also see is that it's a very, very sharp transition. In fact, this transition is also accompanied, if you look at other properties, it's also accompanied by structural changes, symmetry changes, orbital ordering, magnetic ordering. So at the same transition, when the system becomes from a metal to an insulator, it can also get magnetically ordered. It can become from a it can go from a paramagnet to an antiferromagnet. It can become orbitally ordered, so certain orbitals get preferential occupancy. And then it can also be, for example, a symmetry change in the crystal. It can go from a monoclinic to a what is that? I think orthorhombic or something like that. In VO2 it can happen. Okay? In V2O3 also it happens. Yeah.
Sir, is there a hysteresis?
Yes, there is. That's what I was coming to. So if you see here, there is a, as you change the temperature in a certain way, okay, and you reverse this, then you see a hysteresis. Okay, and we are going to see this again in an expanded version of the V2O3, we are going to see this. But what you see here is that this is actually a temperature induced transition. Okay, so as you are changing temperature, the system is going from an insulator to a metal or a metal to an insulator, right? And before we go into this, let me show you the same V2O3 once again. Okay, this is the earlier data was pre-1968. This is 2003 data. Okay, now what you see here is that in the on this axis, it's a 3D phase diagram. This is pressure, this is temperature, and this is conductivity. Okay, so in the one of the first mechanisms that Shomita had pointed out was this Hubbard model scenario, right, where the interaction between electrons was tuned and you could go from a metal to an insulator. But what is happening here is that there is pressure, okay, and this is a pressure induced transition. So you can see that, for example, if you focus on this line, can you all see the cursor? Can you see the cursor that I'm pointing to?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay. So so this system started with a high conductivity, and then as we decreased pressure, then it went to an insulating state. In other words, by increasing pressure, we went from an insulator all the way to a metal. And when we decreased pressure back to the normal pressure, you can see that it did not follow the same path. There is a strong hysteresis. Okay. And the same thing happens for different temperatures, but you see there is a certain temperature, okay, which is around 450-460 Kelvin, where the hysteresis has zero area. Okay, in other words, this is actually a critical point in the phase diagram. In the PT phase diagram, this is actually a critical point. And it turns out this metal insulator transition in V2O3 is exactly the same universality class as a liquid gas transition. Okay, in normal liquids that you see, right, in water, for example, if you see a liquid gas transition, there is a critical point. And this turns out to have the same universality class. So this is so surprising. You see totally different systems, totally different mechanisms, but exactly the same exponents, exactly the same scaling, and so on. Okay. Anyway, that's not the point. The point here is that you can use pressure also to induce this. But what is the mechanism? Okay, so let me come to that. And okay, so before I go to this, the last slide, let me explain what is the mechanism for pressure-induced metal insulator transition. Okay, and is that related to electrostatic screening or not? Okay, so first of all, this pressure induced transition is like this. Let's say that I had atoms which were completely isolated and far apart. So let's say there was D, okay, this is D here, and this D was, let's say, much greater than A0 or three times A0, for example. So imagine a 1D lattice of monovalent atoms which are sitting very far from each other, okay, and say they have S orbitals. So the S orbitals have some probability distribution which looks like this, and each of these atoms are so far from each other that when D is much greater than 3A0, then there is no overlap between the wave functions, okay? But as you start decreasing the D, so decreasing the D, then wave functions start to overlap, okay? And if the wave functions start to overlap, then you can see that there is going to be a band of energies. And because there is going to be a band of energies, you will start seeing conduction. Okay, so the idea here is very, very simple. The idea here is that if the distance between the atoms was very large, there would be almost no overlap between the wave functions. But as you start bringing the atoms closer and closer, which you can do using pressure, then you can make these wave functions overlap with each other, which is going to change the bandwidth, okay, of the bands of the electron band. And by changing the bandwidth, you're basically controlling something called a U by D ratio. So here you see that this was an insulator to begin with, and it became a metal below a certain threshold. Okay, so if the D was less than a certain threshold or a critical D, you would find a metal. So this is an insulator to metal transition induced by pressure. This is one mechanism, okay? But what is happening here is that the Hubbard model that Shomita had mentioned was actually used for understanding the control of this metal insulator transition through something called a U by D ratio, where this U is actually the electron-electron repulsion. But this electron-electron repulsion in the Hubbard model is a very, very special kind of a repulsion. Okay? It's actually purely local or on-site, which means two electrons feel this repulsion only when they are sitting on a single site. So it's an extremely short-range repulsion. Remember, Mott did not have this idea. What Mott said was, normally the potential is a 1 over r. So two electrons, even if they are very far from each other, they should be feeling the repulsion between each other. However, due to electrostatic screening, the repulsion becomes extremely short-ranged, and they don't, right? But if you control the electron density, then they can start feeling the repulsion once again, and that would be a density, electron density controlled insulator to metal transition. Here we are not doing that. Here the idea is that the repulsion is extremely short-ranged. So we are not tuning the repulsion at all, okay? What we are tuning is the repulsion to the bandwidth ratio. And by tuning the repulsion to the bandwidth ratio, we are tuning the system from a metal or an insulator to a metal, or the other way around. Okay, so this is a pressure induced insulator to metal transition, but this does not fall into the same category as what Mott had envisaged. Okay, so is this point clear, that this is a kind of a Mott transition, and this is what is seen in many systems like VO2, V2O3 and all that. Okay, and there is a lot of debate going on, by the way. It's not completely clear whether V2O3, VO2, the metal insulator transitions that are seen are exactly the Hubbard model kind of scenarios. Okay, there are more complicated scenarios as well, but this is one thing. Okay, then we talked about density controlled.
Sir, what is the bandwidth here? I cannot understand that
control. Okay, fine. Yeah, sorry, I made some assumptions there. See, basically what happens is that if you have done a solid state physics course, then you know that there is a certain hopping between the electrons. Have you read the tight binding model? Have you studied the tight binding
model? No, sir.
No? Okay. That's okay. I will tell you what, I mean, we will be actually doing the chronic penny model and the tight binding model as well. Basically, the electrons have a certain amplitude to hop from site to site. Okay. And that hopping, let's denote it by T. This T turns out to be given by the overlap of the kinetic energy operator between the two wave functions on two different sites. Okay. Is this clear?
Yeah.
Right. So if you take the kinetic energy operator and find its matrix element between the wave functions on two different sites, that turns out to determine this hopping matrix element. Okay. And it turns out that when we read, let's say, band theory, right, then the electron energy levels, which were completely isolated, let's say 1s, 2s, 2p, 3p, 3d, and so on, these are isolated energy levels for a hydrogen atom, right? But if you bring them closer, then these energy levels start to overlap, okay? These wave functions start to overlap. And when these wave functions start to overlap, there is a particular amplitude for the electrons to hop from one site to the next site. Okay. And you can imagine that if I and J were extremely far from each other, then the Tij would be extremely small. Okay.
Yeah.
And if you bring them closer and closer, then the T will become larger and larger. Okay. So essentially, you can think of this also as the U by T ratio, where the pressure is controlling the T, the hopping, and not the U. You understand? Okay. So the related point is that the bandwidth actually is proportional to the hopping parameter. But anyway, this is not a very important thing for this argument. All I'm trying to tell you is that Mott had envisaged changing the electrostatic potential itself, right? The U itself. But yeah, what ended up happening in this scenario is that by tuning the pressure, you are changing this hopping integral. And by changing the hopping integral, you're changing the ratio of the localizing potential to the delocalizing term. Remember, the hopping will delocalize the electrons. Okay. And all you're doing by changing pressure, by increasing pressure, is that you're leading to a delocalization of the electrons. Isn't that right? By increasing the T, you're leading to a delocalization, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Is this clear now?
Yeah, so while applying pressure, we are assuming that U will not change.
Exactly, because in the particular scenario that Shumita had mentioned, the U is actually a term which is extremely, extremely short-ranged already. Okay, we have taken into account all the electrostatic screening into the term, and the U becomes operative only when two electrons are sitting on the same site. In fact, I'll show you what the form of that term is. The form of that term is basically U times N up times N down. Okay, so the site index is the same on both the operators. So this is electron density on site I with upspin. This is electron density on the same site I with the downspin. Okay, and if you look at Ni and Nj, then that term is taken to be zero in the plane Hubbard model. So there is no repulsion between two electrons on two different sites. Okay. And by tuning pressure, you can't tune anything locally. You can tune only something which connects two different atoms. Is that clear? Yeah.
Yeah, it's clear. Yeah.
So the density controlled is another way. And the density control, for example, which happens in semiconductors by doping. Okay, that is also a metal insulator transition. And in fact, this was earlier thought that this density control transition is in fact leading or is in fact coming from the original concepts that Mott had given. But again, it turns out that the electrostatic screening is not exactly controlled by the doping. Okay, doping introduces many other mechanisms as well. Okay, so it not only introduces extra electrons or extra holes into the system, it also changes the dielectric constant, it also introduces disorder into the system, it forms impurity bands. So there are many different effects, and it's not the clean concept of reducing electrostatic screening that Mott had envisaged. Okay. So, but it turns out that there is a certain material that has been found recently, which apparently looks like corresponding to the same concepts that Mott had given. Okay. So this is what I wanted to show you. This is a recent paper, 2015, which appeared in the Proceedings of National Academy of Sciences. it's a 2015 paper, and it's the material here is lead chromate. So what you see here is resistance as a function of pressure. Okay, and this is something called an alpha phase, and at 280 Kelvin. Okay, so if you fix the temperature at 280 Kelvin, then what you see is that the resistivity or the resistance decreases sharply, and then there is a kink here and the resistance goes over to this line. Okay, so remember, this is at a fixed temperature, but if you change the temperature from 280 to 300 Kelvin, then what you see is that there is a hysteresis. Okay, so increasing pressure gives you this, whereas decreasing pressure gives you this. Why is this an insulator to metal transition? It's because the resistance is very high here, okay, at low pressure. And as you increase the pressure, the resistance drops by almost 2 to 3 orders of magnitude. Okay. And if you look at this sigma minus sigma C, okay, this is something that is done for phase transitions. And what you see is that there is an exponent which appears, which is 1/3. Okay. And if you look at the phase diagram of this material, this is pressure versus temperature. It's a very rich phase diagram. And as a, if you go to lower and lower temperatures, then you see that there is an antiferromagnetic metal. And sorry, this is an antiferromagnet, and it's also multiferroic. But as you increase the pressure, you go to a metal. Okay, so this is an insulator, but it's not a plain insulator. It's actually magnetically ordered. And it's also multiferroic, so it responds, the magnetism responds to electric field. Okay, and as you increase the pressure, the system becomes a metal. And apparently what these guys have argued in this paper is that the metal insulator transition in this material corresponds to the original concepts of Mott, that is the reduction of electrostatic screening or increasing the electrostatic screening through pressure. Okay, but these are very complicated set of arguments, but if somebody is interested, we can discuss that. Okay, so are there any questions,
sir?
Yeah,
sir. In this potential, when two electrons are on same side, then they feel repulsion. Then yes. How can we find the repulsion magnitude of this repulsion?
How can we find it?
Magnitude of EU, is it a constant or something depends on the position? Distance between them.
Correct. So, so the idea is this. See, suppose I take a normal, let's say I take the d orbital, right? So what I can do is I can take psi d of r, okay, and I can find out if I put two electrons into this orbital psi d, into this d orbital, and I take a 1/r potential, okay, then what will be the matrix element of this 1/r potential if both the electrons occupy the d orbital? Okay, so how do I do that? I take psi d of r1, psi d of r2, 1/r1 minus r2 mod, and then psi d of r2, psi d of r1. I can do this, right?
Yes, sir. Yeah. I understood.
Yeah, this will be E squared and 4 pi epsilon naught, all that. So with this, you will get a U. Okay. But remember, the R1 and R2 here correspond to coordinates with respect to the same atom. Okay. So R1 and R2 have exactly the same origin. If I want to find out, let's say, the repulsion between two electrons which are sitting here and here, the neighboring sides, okay, then what I would have to do is I would have to add here R1 minus R2, but R2 is measured from a different nearest neighbor, something like this, okay, and that would give me a U dash, And in practice, what has been seen is that the U dash is actually much smaller than the U. Okay. So this electrostatic repulsion is only very, very strong only when the two electrons are sitting in exactly the same d orbital on the same side. Okay.
Sir, when they are on same side, should it not be the delta function?
No, it's not. See, remember, it's not, these are not point, nothing is a point, right? See, remember, in a hydrogen atom, or you take any different atom, right? In a multi-electron atom, aren't there many electrons on the same side? So suppose I take a sodium atom, how many electrons are there?
11,
right? And all the 11 electrons in an isolated sodium atom are sitting on site, right? On the same site. Isn't it?
Okay, sir. Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's the idea. So essentially, what we are saying is, let's say if I take a crystal of sodium, right? And already electrons are present here. If another electron tries to hop in to this, okay, and remember the outermost is in the 3s, right? So if another electron tries to hop into the 3s, right, then what would be the repulsion between the 3s electron of sodium and the extra electron that has hopped in? That is what we are trying to find using this U. Is that okay?
Yes, sir. There was some misconception. I thought that the same orbital or same position the electrons would be. So it is clear.
Fermion. So they occupy the same quantum numbers anyway, right? They have to have different set of quantum numbers. Okay. But spatially, they could belong to the same orbital. That is not a problem because an orbital always has a finite extension in real space.
Sir.
Yeah.
Sir, actually, I didn't understand the reason for hysteresis.
Oh, you didn't understand the reason for hysteresis. Okay, I didn't explain that. So let me explain that. So suppose I start with a system, let's say, which was an insulator to begin with, and it goes over to a metal, let's say, and then when it comes back to an insulator. Okay. So this is increasing pressure. So this is pressure. And the question is, why should there be a hysteresis at all? Okay. So so we know that magnets have hysteresis, right? Let's say if I consider ferromagnets, then usually ferromagnets have a hysteresis as a function of field. So if I look at magnetization as a function of field, then we usually draw this kind of hysteresis curves. So is this Saptarishi?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Saptarishi, you know that magnetization versus field has a hysteresis curve, right?
Yes.
So do you know why this hysteresis occurs in magnets?
Yes, like the orientation of that dipoles.
Yes.
They preserve their position till a certain.
So what you are saying is, let's say I take a certain system where all the spins are aligned. Okay. And I from here. Start decreasing, make the field is zero, then I find that I have been able to turn only a partial number of spins. I have not been able to tune all the spins to be in the negative direction. Okay, so only a fraction of the spins have become opposite to the field, right? So this is at H much larger than zero. This is H is equal to zero. And only when you go to H extremely large and negative, only then you find that all the spins have aligned with the field, right?
Yes.
Now, how to understand this from a free energy argument?
Actually, sir, I forgot, but I think there was something related to domain wall formation or
domain wall formation, but you can also understand it from this. So if I consider the free energy potential, okay, as a function of the order parameter, okay, so it turns out that it has a double well potential where all the spins aligned in one direction and all the spins aligned have exactly the same value. Okay, what you're doing by tuning the field, so this is at zero field, okay, this is at zero field, right? What you're doing by tuning the field is that you're changing the relative depth of these minima. So let's say this is the minima corresponding to the up spins and this is the minima corresponding to the down spins. Okay, so what we are saying is if the field was zero, there is an equal probability for every spin to be up or down. It's a proper disordered paramagnet. Okay, but when the field is positive, right, then what we are doing is we are making it more favorable for the spins to be in the plus, in the up direction rather than in the down direction, like this. So the minimum would be lower for the up spin rather than for the down spin. Okay, and if you make the field larger and larger, so even larger, okay, this is bad notation, but bear with me. Basically, what you're doing is that you're making the other minimum completely disappear. So this will keep moving up and this will become the global minimum. That's why you see this. Okay, so this is when H is very large.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so essentially the same thing is happening here. Okay, exactly. See, this is a first order transition and there is a certain point at which the first order transition is supposed to happen. Okay, but what is happening is equivalent to what you're seeing in the magnets and what you also see in liquids, by the way. You know that in liquids there is a super cooled state and there is a super heated state, right? A super cooled state is when a liquid remains a liquid even below the freezing temperature, which means that it is actually in a metastable state. See, this state is actually called a metastable state and this is the global minimum. So what happens is a part of the system remains in the metastable state and only a larger fraction of the system goes into the global minimum. Okay, so here also the same thing is happening, that you start from the insulating state, but as you're applying pressure, not the entire system does not actually go over to the metallic state. Okay, a part of the system remains in the insulating state. So you get domain formation, you get metal insulator islands here also. Okay, in fact, I have a presentation where we have done this analysis very carefully. And I mean, we have looked at the universality classes and so on. But basically, there are these domain maps using infrared spectroscopy. Okay, so using infrared spectroscopy, one can actually find out what is the local conductivity of a certain material. And what they have seen is that there are local pockets where the conductivity is very high and there are other pockets where the conductivity is extremely low. So which means there is a domain formation in the system related to this metal insulator islands. Okay.
And so that's basically for materials?
Yeah. Sorry?
Does it apply for all materials, these arguments?
Actually, this applies to a very, very large class of materials. In fact, the metal insulator transition is one thing. There are magnetic transitions, there are charge ordering transitions, and there's even a superconducting transition. So there are superconducting islands and normal islands. There are systems where charge ordering happens in certain islands and the other islands are charge paraelectric, so to say. There's no polarization, for example. So there are all kinds of first order transitions where these hysteresis takes place. Is that what you're asking?
Yes, yes. And yeah. So actually, just one more thing. You showed the different, the hysteresis graphs for different materials. So mm-hmm. I saw Ti2O3 shows that MOT insulator transition, but TiO mm-hmm. does not. Why is it? Because they are both essentially similar materials, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the thing is, you have to really go into the physics and chemistry of the material. So I'm stressing on this. Okay. There is physics and chemistry here. What happens is if you take a different oxide, then you have to figure out what are the orbitals that are occupied. Okay. Whether it's the d orbital bands that are active that give you the valence electrons, whether it's the s orbital electrons that are giving you the valence electrons. Okay. the d electron bands turn out to be extremely narrow, okay? And if the d electron bands have, or if the band has a narrow bandwidth, then the interaction energy can actually assume a dominant role, and you can tune the system from an insulator to a metal. However, if you take systems where the valence bands are formed by extremely delocalized orbitals like s and p, for example, if you take sodium or copper, then trying to localize them is extremely, extremely hard. Okay. Yeah, I mean, try turning copper into an insulator using any method. Okay. It's almost impossible. Right. So it turns out that there are these materials which are easily tunable, but it's not easy at all. In fact, there is a very interesting history to this. See, if you remember, hydrogen was predicted to be a metal at extremely large pressures. Okay, in fact, not just a metal, it was predicted to become a superconductor. But there have been many groups, including Professor Chandrabas's group, which has applied extremely large pressures, okay, of the order of hundreds of gigapascal. So, and it was found that hydrogen does become metallic, but there is actually a controversy in that. But an outcome of this was that people tried doing the same thing with hydrides, and there they found high temperature superconductivity. Okay, so hydrogen as a gas, right, when you try to compress it, then you're bringing the hydrogen atoms closer and closer, right? And then the prediction was that hydrogen in its extremely dense form should show metallic behavior. So it should go from a insulating gas-like state to a metallic solid-like state, okay? But that still is debated, but the superconducting transition in hydrides has been extremely well confirmed. And it has in fact given us the first room temperature superconductor as well, okay? So sorry, I probably digressed. I don't remember your original question.
No, sir, that is okay, I understood. But in that case, like, I mean, where did you take the chemical nature of electron into account in the treatment you have given?
Where did I take that into account?
Like you are saying, like, electron means it depends on from where it is coming, which band, right?
That's correct, yeah. So you remember what I said was that RTF is basically the screening length, right? The Thomas Fermi screening length. Now, if you look at the expression for the Thomas Fermi screening length, it depends purely on the electron density.
Okay. Yes, sir, I see that. Sorry.
So electron density is one way to tune the Mott transition, but that was the original concept of Mott. Okay. What pressure does is that it is changing not exactly the Thomas Fermi screening length, it is changing the Hopping integral for the electrons. And that is controlled, that is controlling the bandwidth. And so what you're doing is basically a bandwidth controlled insulator to metal transition. Okay, not a electrostatic screening controlled insulator to metal transition. It's not a screening tuned transition. Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Sorry, I wanted to do thermionic emission as well, but it's only 6 minutes remaining. So let me do this next time.
Sir, yeah. I have a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sir, you just whatever. Ferromagnetic transition, you showed that there is a double well potential, and yeah, when we apply magnetic field, one potential well is deep and other is shallow. But correct. In the case where R versus pressure curve in your PP, that above certain temperature it was not showing hysteresis, but at a temperature 280 Kelvin it was increasing temperature, it was showing hysteresis. So why this is happening? And sir, also in magnetic system, so there was a degeneracy in magnetic system, we know, but here we are also seeing some hysteresis. So is there any other crucial or inherent degeneracy?
Yeah, there is. So let's go back to something that you would have studied long ago. Okay. Remember the PV isotherm in an ideal gas? So the PV isotherm in an ideal gas, how does it look like? It looks like this, right? You remember?
Yes, sir.
Yeah? Now, what happens to a real gas? What is the equation of state for a real gas? Do you remember?
Band gas equation.
Yeah, what is that equation? P?
P plus A by V square.
Yeah.
Into V minus V summon at equal to RT.
Correct. Okay. So what is the main difference that you see between the ideal gas equation and this equation?
Sir, in V axis there is P is decreasing fast, but below some temperature there is a hump.
Exactly. So what you see is this, right? So in fact, if you do this, you get this, correct? But you do a Maxwell construction and you say that the system does not actually follow this curve. So ideally the system should be following this curve, okay? But it does not follow that, right? What you say is that the system actually follows this. There is a whole regime where the system, the liquid and the gas coexist. And above a certain critical point, there is an inflection point and the liquid and gas do not, they coexist, right? But there is no first order transition. There is no latent heat involved, right? It's a continuous transition. Isn't that right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So the idea here is also that if you have two transitions, if you have two degenerate minima like this, okay, and you want to go from one minimum to the other minimum, then you will have a first order transition. Okay, but what would happen if the two minima were to be extremely close to each other? You bring the minima closer and closer by tuning the temperature. Okay, at a certain point, there will be only one global minimum. Okay, and this is like the fluid state. This is the magnetically ordered state. So you are not only controlling the depth of this minima individually by tuning the magnetic field, by temperature, what you're doing is you're controlling the overall strength of the. You understand? So temperature does not distinguish different spins, so to say. Okay. Temperature is controlling the entire free energy curve by tuning the strength of these minima, both the minima. Okay.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Then I think the free energy is related to some parameter in magnetism. It is magnetization. The parameter constant AB is dependent on temperature, and we are varying this, and we are getting something hysteresis.
Correct. And remember, if you want to read more about this, read Landau-Ginzburg theory. Okay. In Landau-Ginzburg theory, the free energy can actually be expanded as in a Taylor's expansion, okay, and you can see that there are actually terms which relate to this, where this is the order parameter. So you can do a Taylor's expansion in terms of the order parameter, and these coefficients turn out to be dependent on temperature, field, and other quantities. Okay, and using this Landau-Ginzburg theory, you can actually explain many of these phenomena. First order transitions, second order transitions, and so on. So the Landau-Ginzburg theory actually gives you a very powerful framework to understand phase transitions.
Yes, sir. I was telling about this. The constant was ABC or something.
Correct.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir.
Okay. Okay, so we'll meet tomorrow at 4 o'clock, and I think this Teams is working, so let me just stop recording.